First learned my neighbor was Whitey Bulger on Wednesday, June 22nd, 2011. Taking a nap on my couch, I got a phone call from front desk at the hotel I was managing at the time. And my coworker put me on the phone with an FBI agent who needed to ask me about a tenant at the apartment building I managed across the street.
I went in to look for the manager of the Princess Eugenia Apartments and asked him to come over. Little reluctance at first, but understandably. I asked him a few general questions. Then I slid him some pictures, photos of Catherine and Whitey. And there was an immediate reaction, which led me to believe I was on the right track when the manager put his hands in his head.
It was, you know, pretty surreal. It was, I was shocked. You don't really find out somebody you know or somebody who's kind of in your peripheral or your neighbor is a fugitive.
You're talking, once again, about a person with probably six decades of criminal behavior. And, I mean, it's, you know, anyone does anything for six decades, they're probably going to be good at it. And he was a master criminal.
I think what makes Whitey Bulger so fascinating is his psychology as, you know, a supreme narcissist, a psychopath. Everything is always about him and his ability to adapt to situations and wear what I would call various masks, masks of Whitey Bulger, so that he can move almost seamlessly from a crime boss and killer in Boston, who for years was on the top, you know, of his profession. And then suddenly he has to switch into the life of a fugitive from justice and emerge in Santa Monica, California, hiding in plain sight as a retiree Charlie Gasco. How does he do that? How does he flip that switch? A lot of other people without his kind of makeup and discipline would, after a while, need a fix, whether it was the thrill of a kill or the recognition that came with being on top of the underworld here in Boston, the power, the money. And I think all those things matter to Whitey. I think he enjoyed killing. I think he enjoyed ruling the underworld and having that power. But for him, I think he got the most satisfaction from this sense of control. He was always out front. Catch me if you can. Free and clear of his pursuers. The circumstances have changed, but the game has not. Catch me if you can.
Every time I think about that night, I think about it almost with goosebumps, because we were right outside. We, the Boston media, some reporters, certainly I was there, outside the federal courthouse in Post Office Square in Boston, and we were waiting for the arrival of a guy named John Salvi. It was arctic, absolutely arctic. We were jumping up and down, stomping our feet, trying to keep warm, waiting for his arrival. All of a sudden, I get the word that Stephen Fleming's just been arrested three blocks away from us. And that's how that story broke.
The whole case centered around the fact that he was, you know, one of the most dangerous individuals in the Boston area for so many years. But what complicated the whole investigation at the time was the fact that he had been an FBI informant for so many years. So during our investigation, we were constantly running into roadblocks where the FBI would more or less try to protect Bulger and his partner, Stephen Rifleman Fleming. And to the point where eventually we were able to find a couple of US attorneys that were trying to do the right thing. Fred Weinshack, Brian Kelly initially teamed up alongside us. When we were eventually able to bring in the information before the grand jury to get an indictment on them, we were running into a lot of roadblocks at the time from not only the FBI, but also some people within the U.S. Attorney's Office. We felt very strongly that this was our opportunity for the first time to get indictments on Bulger and Fleming, and that if we missed him now, we might not ever get another chance. And we questioned, we really questioned what their intent was here.
The FBI did not want to go down with this indictment. They didn't want it to happen, they fought it, and they only reluctantly signed on to one count of it after Foley said he'd go public if they didn't join in.
Based upon our insistence that he be indicted, we were pretty happy to even get the go-ahead to go out and serve those warrants on that group.
A day before the indictment was really going to come out, they were looking for them to make the arrest on the warrant, which had not yet been made public.
I was supervising the state police investigators that were going to be doing the warrants that night, that were going to be out there seeking Bulger and Fleming and a number of mafia individuals also. The U.S. Attorney's Office wanted the FBI involved also at the time. We separated the individuals and put teams of troopers and agents on certain individuals. So we targeted Fleming. The FBI insisted that they had Bulger in pocket, that they were able to pick him up anytime they needed to. And there was a third individual, the mafia captain, Frank Salemi, which we both teamed up to target him, to bring him down. The plan was, once we found Fleming, we would notify the FBI and they would pick up Bulger.
The FBI assured the state police, Bulger's in pocket, we got him. Bulger's in pocket, we got him. So the feds went after Salemi, they lost him. The day goes on, no Bulger, no Salemi. Fleming hasn't shown up either. Now they're getting nervous. The guys with Foley want to know whether they go home. Foley had a particular instinct. He said, let's give it an hour more. Within an hour, Fleming shows up with his sons at a property he was developing as a restaurant close to the federal courthouse where we're waiting, and they get him. First thing he wants to do, he wants to talk to the FBI. Well, he was a secret informant. He expected the FBI was going to protect them.
We knew once the word got out that one of them was arrested that it was gonna wake up this whole community in Boston area, and the word was gonna be out there. So we knew we had to get him fast. And this is exactly what happened. You know, the night we went out and we arrested Fleming, the word all of a sudden, once he got on the phone, making a phone call, it got out there and it was like Boston all of a sudden, lights were going on all over that community down there. We called the FBI and we said, okay, you can take down Bulger now. And, you know, the fact of the matter is that, you know, Bulger had already fled the area, that they didn't have Bulger in pocket, and he was long gone. And we started scrambling to find out to see if we could find him. And actually, the FBI was parked on the South Boston address that his girlfriend, Teresa Stanley, lived at, and they were looking at the wrong house when we pulled up.
They'd been sitting outside the wrong house all day long. This gives you an idea of our FBI at work in Boston, and it gives you an understanding why people were suspect of the FBI and had so little regard for them and so little faith that they were going to be able to do anything right. At the end of the day, the guy that they had in pocket, long gone, as we know, for 16 years. At the end of December, before Christmas, in 1994, John Connolly, who was Bulger and Fleming's FBI handler, who was retired but kept close contacts with the Bureau because he was a prince of the city, Connolly found Bulger's sidekick and surrogate son, Kevin Weeks, who had no idea that Bulger was an informant. Suspicious of Connolly, what do you want? I need to talk to you. I need to tell you, you need to get to Bulger and Fleming and tell them. Bulger has been secretly indicted, along with Fleming and Salemi. That was the tip that it was claimed that Bulger always wanted, a heads up. Weeks found him. He was Christmas shopping with Teresa Stanley. He told them, indictment's coming down, and boom, they took off.
The thing about Whitey, and this, again, goes to his brain power and his discipline, he had been planning for the possibility that someday he would have to hit the road. And he did that in a way that I think distances and illustrates the difference between him and Fleming. Fleming hid money in his mother's house, you know, in South Boston, in the chimney or whatnot. Whitey, who enjoyed traveling, enjoyed vacationing, always had work on his mind on some level because he deposited money around the country and around the world in the event that someday he would have to be on the run.
As it turned out, he had started getting aliases in the 1970s. Go to an old newspaper morgue, 1929, find a baby who had died in 1929, go down to City Hall, get their birth certificate, then take the birth certificate to the Registry of Motor Vehicles, get a driver's license.
He had two girlfriends for quite some time, and I think the only two people around here didn't know that were the two girlfriends. So initially, when he left the area based on some rumors that these indictments were coming down, he took Teresa Stanley with him. And I don't think it was a life that Teresa really wanted to live. So he brought her back, and he picked up his other girlfriend, Catherine Gregg, who decided she wanted to live that type of life.
Teresa Stanley was older. She loved her children. She just wasn't built to go on the lam at age 60. Whereas at the time, Catherine Gregg is 40 years old. Her husband is former Boston firefighter, dead of a drug overdose. Her two brothers-in-law murdered by Whitey. All she's got is a twin sister and two poodles, Nikki and Gigi. So she didn't really have a lot to leave behind here in Boston.
So back he came to South Shore of Boston, a place called Hingham. I thought it's poetic. Dropped her off at a Chili's restaurant with a Sia. And then he had already prearranged for Catherine to be meeting him in Malibu Beach. So he came north to Boston, picked her up on the beach, they reunited, and off they went, Kathy and Jimmy.
Like everybody else, I assumed it would only be a matter of days until they picked him up, but that was not to be, obviously. And I think a lot of it had to do with just the general lack of interest that the FBI had at the time in Boston in finding this guy. He was too close to them.
He should have been caught that in 95 and 96. And I think the case can now be made that it he got away because of the still deeply compromised FBI. The two basic rules of fugitive life is to cut all ties with the home front and don't talk to anybody and obviously assume a new identity. Those are basic. And yet the first year and a half when he was out there, as he was, what I would say, trying to find traction or his sea legs, so to speak, he was constantly in touch through largely Kevin Weeks with his family, with his brother Jackie in particular, but also Bill. I think he was staying in touch to reassure his family, meaning his brothers, that he's okay, and constantly coming up with false IDs, some of it involving the money. Those are terrible mistakes to be making or terrible things to be doing. But he could get away with it because the FBI was in charge of the manhunt.
We were officially told by the U.S. Attorney's Office that the FBI was going to be in charge of the fugitive investigation. You know, we had a little problem with that. We built the case. We knew the ins and the outs. Most of our investigators were naturally from the Boston area, knew the families, knew the locations, knew the people, knew his habits, had watched him for a long time. Yet, you know, we were told all that information was going to be going into the FBI.
The FBI insisted on being charged with the manhunt. They assigned it to the Organized Crime Squad, which was the squad Whitey had controlled for so many decades. That's laugh out loud in hindsight. That's pathetic.
It took them over 2 years to put a task force together to find him. It took them more time. I think it was 4 or 5 years before he was named one of America's most wanted. There was very little being done by the FBI to find him.
So Teresa Stanley's home in South Boston in the spring of 1995. The FBI didn't go to interview her or try to get information from her for over a year later, all right? Had they, and then she cooperated then, and she revealed to them the alias that Whitey went under, Tom Baxter and Helen Baxter. Those were his aliases out there. He had a car registered in those names, he had a driver's license in those names, and that was, again, part of Whitey's preparation for being on the road.
September 1995, Long Beach, Mississippi. A police officer, Rudy Ladner, is driving his car, sees a New York plate in front of him. The light has turned green, but the car hasn't gone because the car driver has looked in his rearview mirror and apparently seen the cop car and has hesitated. Ladner's suspicious. Thinks New Yorkers, okay, this part of the town, resort town, maybe they're up to no good. Calls in the plate to NCIC. Thomas Baxter shows up, Selden, New York, no criminal record. Meanwhile, he gets a call. He's thinking about pulling him over because the driver looks suspicious. He passes the driver. The driver turns to the right, but he's been called to an accident. Rudy Ladner at that point might have been the closest cop to ever get to Whitey Bulger as a fugitive.
But had the FBI learned very early that he was going by the alias Tom Baxter and flagged that in the National Criminal, you know, Record Index, boom, he might have been captured.
They also didn't ask Teresa Stanley if she knew where any of the money was stashed. Now, we now know that Whitey had safe deposit boxes in London, Dublin, Montreal, Clearwater, Florida. Those are just the ones we know of. So if we found four, how many do you think he really had?
But it became, I think, apparent to him that the heat was, instead of lessening, was increasing, and he had to cut all ties. He had a meeting in the fall of 1996, his last one with Kevin Weeks, and that's the last time Kevin Weeks ever saw him or heard from him. And by the end of the year, he and Catherine, you know, drove, I mean, pulled into Santa Monica, California, and discovered their new life there.
A lot of agencies wanted a piece of this case. This case had everything. It was a big fugitive case. It had some IRA connections, sort of terrorism connections through the IRA. There were murders, there was organized crime. It had everything, and therefore almost everybody who was anybody in law enforcement wanted a piece of this action, and had tried, a lot of people had tried to put Bulger away over the years, and it hadn't happened, and there was a lot of heartache between agencies because of that.
The effort to find him was sincere on some FBI members' parts, and the initial task force, those members were somewhat very anxious to capture him because they weren't from the old school of the old guard. They didn't care about John Connolly or the other agents. The only trouble was the people in Washington that they reported to still were part of the old guard. And Bulger was something that they didn't want to expose because it was going to embarrass them.
We never had any reason to think that he was deceased. There was never anything that gave us reason to think he was not still alive. And so we always had to presume he was still alive. Until we had proof that he wasn't, we still had to continue the search.
The task force itself, comprised of multiple state and local agencies and the FBI, brought about a vast amount of resources in order for us to conduct both a national manhunt but also a global manhunt. So that was our mission at the time, and it remained our mission all the way to his capture.
I was convinced that there was some collusion with the FBI, possibly to an unfair degree. For somebody to disappear and stay gone for the length of time, I felt that there had to be some collusion. I think that's not true. I think what it was is that they just weren't looking for him, but they weren't actively helping him. I mean, I thought that was the case for a while, but not so.
The International Chiefs of Police Association was coming to Boston. So I suggested to the task force that they do a 20-minute documentary about Bulger. Show this to all those chiefs of police from around the world. Have them take a video back to them that they can give to their detectives, their uniformed patrol captains, and have them filter it down to the troops, the men and women on the street. They're the backbone of any law enforcement agency. They interact with the community. That's gonna shrink his circle of geographic area where he could be running off to. They thought it was a great idea. They wrote a request to Washington, D.C. to do it. The request came back denied. When I asked them why, they said, could prove embarrassing to the Bureau.
The case wasn't finished. It was something that none of us wanted to let go or could let go. It was kind of part of our lives for so many years, and we felt so strongly about it. So then whenever there was any opportunity to get out there and get some publicity for the fact that he was still out there, you know, we actively went out and did it, a lot of us on our own time, you know, because we wanted to, you know, finally be able to bring him into court and hold him accountable for how many lives he destroyed over so many years.
In Boston, for the last generation, everything still comes down to two things, the Red Sox and Whitey. It's part of the culture. And while he was gone, that was the line, where's Whitey? Everybody's talking, where's Whitey? You think he's alive?
The trail for him was difficult to track because of his skillfulness. He was just very skilled at remaining a fugitive, as evident in how he conducted himself in Santa Monica. He kept a low profile. He focused on an area with a lot of transient people who would not pay attention to him. He remained really elusive for us.
He had discipline, you know, he never really drank, never did any kind of drugs, spent a lot of time reading Soldier of Fortune magazine and learning how to get IDs and how to remain out there on a fugitive status. So, you know, you don't run into fugitives like that often.
He knew at some point he was going to get indicted, and the FBI and the DEA and the Strike Force and everybody else was going to be looking to arrest him, and he was probably gone forever. He planned for that. He already had his fake ID, that Baxter ID, and some other ones in the wind. He took Teresa Stanley in 1994 on a round-the-country driving tour, and what he was doing was figuring out where he was going to go when the indictment came down. Most fugitives don't have that luxury. If you do something in the heat of passion, you know, you don't have time to think, oh, shoot, where am I going? You just go, you get caught. He had money, he had a plan. Bulger had already scoped that out.
He went to a part of the country where probably they didn't know anything about James Whitey Bulger, or very few people knew. And he was able to just blend in with the average person. So that was his success for hiding for the past 16 and a half years.
He would utilize his IQ, his high IQ, his charisma, his manipulation skills to co-opt people into almost doing whatever he wanted them to do.
The homeless were a great opportunity for that because Whitey was always in need of false identifications to get, you know, prescription drugs or whatever.
He went to elderly, white, homeless guys, most of them who had substance abuse problems or alcoholism problems, and he was buying fake ID for a 12-pack of beer.
And so Whitey, who had great people skills when he turned it on in terms of a kind of personal charisma, he basically hit the jackpot with this one Army veteran alcoholic named James Lawler, who was pretty much a lookalike of Whitey Bulger, a little shorter, a little heavier. James Lawler's license needed to be amended, you know, once Whitey got control of it to reflect his height and weight. Lawler was pretty much a hopeless drunk. He actually ended up taking care of Lawler for a while, putting him up in one of those rundown motels, paying his rent for a bunch of years. But that was always in effect to have Lawler on call when he needed to update something in terms of documentation as well. So there was never just pure goodness about Whitey. It was always it was an investment.
That's how he remained a fugitive, and that's why he was so elusive, is because he developed the playbook, the fugitive playbook. And he did not leave a trail. And if he did leave a trail, it was somebody else's trail.
Now comes 2000. America's Most Wanted gets a tip from someone in Fountain Valley, California, that somebody looking like Catherine Grigg had shown up to have her hair done. So there's the sighting. It seemed credible. The Los Angeles office of the FBI at some point releases a statement saying it looks like a reliable sighting. FBI in Boston, outraged that LA is saying this. Now, they never took the opportunity to send their own people out to California to check the story out for themselves. So I thought, I'm traveling. So I went to Fountain Valley. It was a strip mall where the place was located. Somebody was supposed to be out of the car waiting for her. That was part of the story. Across the way is a gas station. Maybe the guy waiting for her went over to the gas station. So I went over to the gas station, showed a couple of mugshots of Bulger. Hey, anybody ever come to you asking about this guy or showing you pictures of somebody who looked like this and asking you if you've seen him? No. Nobody ever came, no. There was a market, there was a florist shop next door. And there was a telephone booth. Maybe he's making some phone calls. Did anybody ever pull the tolls? Nobody ever pulled the tolls out of that phone booth. And it's suspected that Bulger is crossing the border into Mexico to get heart medication. I go to the border, I talk to INS, Immigration Naturalization Service. I said, anybody ever come here from the FBI, show you pictures of this guy, explain that they think he's going across the border? This guy? No, nobody's ever been here. I said, are you sure? He said, let me tell you, if somebody came here and said, we're looking for this guy, we believe he's crossing the border, our guys would get him. We'd have all our guys looking for him. We put up the posters. I gave him the photo. He made copies of the mugshots that I brought to put up to tell his guys, look for them.
Television broadcasting company hired me to try to find him because they had credible information that he was hiding down in Cuba. I went down to Miami and met with some former CIA station chiefs there, and we orchestrated an investigation inside Cuba, and we determined he was not there.
They find a safe deposit box in London in the early 2000s. It's got a key to another safe deposit box in Dublin, which they go into. So they thought he was in the UK at the time.
From that day forward until 2011, his arrest, this was allowed to stand as the last reliable sighting. And early on, from my sources who were coming from New Scotland Yard, I was told it was bogus. The effect of that was detrimental, clearly detrimental to the search for Bulger, because paired with the 2001 attack on 9/11, there was the theory he was out of the country, couldn't get back, it was much more restricted, and so much of the FBI's efforts there were to spread the word of Bulger in Ireland and London. They kept pushing this idea, but they never did an initiative, a public campaign in California.
Once we indicted Stephen Fleming, we knew that he was going to do one of two things. He was going to go to jail and do his time, which we thought was very highly unlikely. He was going to come out and say that him and Bulger were FBI informants, so you can't take us to court. And that's exactly what he did. And at that point there, the FBI had to front the information.
As a result of Bulger leaving, there was a lot of pressure put on his associates, and soon there were stories coming out. And of course, Kevin Weeks led them, which is the best lie detector test you can give, bring us to the bodies, and he did.
They always thought they had the ace in the hole, that if they had to play it, they'd get off. Well, little did they know that this was gonna go a lot further.
We felt pretty confident that if we could get Fleming under indictment, even on some lesser charges, and put him into a situation where he was gonna have to go to jail, that he would end up admitting that he was an FBI informant. And it's exactly what happened.
If they had come back and pleaded the bookie cases, the bookmaking cases, they probably would have been in and out of jail. But because they didn't, more investigations ensued, more people ended up cooperating, they found out about all these murders that were happening at the same time. So more witnesses came across.
Fleming talked, Weeks talked, Martorano, a true killer, talked. Then we found out about the murders, long suspected, but then you had the evidence, you had the bodies.
It's very difficult for anybody to dispute, you know, bones laid upon bones laid upon bones in a grave alongside a highway in Boston, that finally it brought over a lot of public opinion, it brought over a lot of people that would come in and said, you guys have been right all along.
And it was that pressure, the late 90s, when the judge, Mark Wolf, bravely took this on because the FBI wanted this hidden. They didn't want this out. They were forced to reveal, against their will, that Bulger and Fleming were informants. The Department of Justice didn't want to release that. What Judge Wolf had done by holding these hearings was to turn over all the rocks, and there were maggots underneath the rocks.
Thank you.
you know, there was a $1 million reward for his capture. There is now a $2 million reward. It shows the FBI's commitment to catch Bulger. It shows our commitment to seek information concerning his arrest and or capture.
I think that the pressure on our part as a task force was self-induced. We wanted to close that chapter on Winter Hill.
People would ask me, like, in the, you know, after he'd been gone for 5 or 6 years, well, are they still protecting him? And I said, well, no, the new guys aren't protecting him. I mean, this will be the ultimate feather in their cap. I mean, this would be the best thing that could ever happen to an FBI agent, to be the one who captures Whitey Bulger.
That case at that time needed a jump start, and I think management in Boston realized that. They wanted some new people, some fresh blood, which happens a lot in these cases. You bring in new people, you push new buttons, and things happen that haven't happened before.
When I became special agent in charge in July of 2010, we decided to bring the U.S. Marshals in. I immediately had a very, very good relationship with U.S. Marshal John Gibbons. We were both natives of Springfield, Massachusetts. We were Western Massachusetts guys. We bonded very closely when I first got here. And John offered to put Deputy U.S. Marshal Neil Sullivan on our task force.
Well, in every city in the United States, we have a fugitive task force where we, on a daily basis, we're out looking for wanted fugitives, people who have federal and state warrants, a lot of very serious cases, but maybe not quite as infamous as the Bulger case.
Coming on the task force, we would give this thing a fresh look. They're always going to trip up somewhere. Law enforcement, we just have to be very patient. So the transition coming in, Rick, myself, Carmen Ortiz, the United States attorney, we were a great team coming together, and we had to build a great team amongst the people we were gonna assign.
Myself and Special Agent Torsny were both under the same belief that Catherine Grieg was still alive and that she was still with Bulger. That the tip in London in 2002 was not a valid tip, and we believe they were in the U.S. in a warm weather climate. So that Kathy Grieg was an important part of that. I mean, we believed that she would be the more social of the two. She'd be the more likely to be out and about, maybe more recognized.
The mistake he made was traveling with somebody else. If he was able to and had been able to travel by himself and do what he did, he probably wouldn't have been caught. You travel with two people, though, and you double your chances of recognition. You double your chances maybe of getting caught based on somebody doing something stupid or being arrested. So in that respect, being with Catherine hurt him. But I think it helped him more than hurt him.
He would never kill Catherine Gregg because he needs somebody to be with him. You know, if you have a couple just moving around the world, they could be tourists, they could be anybody. Whereas if Whitey's by himself, I mean, anyone who ever knew him knows that he's given off these really weird serial killer vibes. Plus, even when he leaves at age 65, he's already got a heart condition. Eventually, he's gonna become infirm, and he will need somebody to go out and get him those prescriptions. Whitey never could have survived without Catherine Gregg.
Bulger had been on America's Most Wanted, I believe, 15 times, and it never had worked. I mean, we tried all the traditional methods to catch fugitives, but after the 9 months I was there trying everything that we would usually try, it became apparent pretty quickly that we were probably not gonna locate and arrest Bulger without a tip. You know, we felt we were in a position where we had to create our own luck.
The story starts with myself and another agent, Tommy McDonald, talking to Kevin Weeks. It was a Monday or Sunday night. We knocked on his door in his apartment. We go up there, he's watching football. Come on in, we go in, we sit down. Weeks tells us, you know, different things, not a whole lot. We're asking, where's Bulger? We wanna know where Bulger, this is simple. Where's he at? We'll get out of your hair, be done with it. He'd been through the ringer, been through all kinds of stuff. But one thing he told us is that at one point, Bulger physically accosted the one girlfriend. Weeks was scared for that girl. He was concerned maybe something had happened to this girl. Maybe Bulger had done something to the girlfriend. We knew he had a temper. We knew he was a guy who was violent, certainly. And over breakfast the next morning, I said, you know, what if she's dead? You know, we got to cover all our bases here, Tommy. What if she's dead? The other thing we knew about Grieg is that she had had breast implants. And when you're looking for somebody and somebody has something with numbers on them, and you think they might be dead or might pass away in the future, you get those numbers in the computer. Your driver's license, social security number, license plate on a car. In her case, we didn't have a license plate on a car. We had a date of birth or social security number, and we're thinking breast implants. Do breast implants have serial numbers? Sure they do. If this girl were passed away or something had happened to her and she had not been identified, a pathologist during autopsy would take the serial numbers off them and hopefully give them to law enforcement if it was an unidentified female, and you'd find out who this girl was through the serial numbers if we had them in the computer. We sort of camped out on some different people, talked to people they told us to talk to, and as a result of talking to somebody in Boston, we came up with information where she had had plastic surgery, which was previously unknown. We got the appropriate paperwork, gave it to the hospitals, gave it to the doctors. Besides the serial numbers, we got some pictures of Catherine Grieg that were, for somebody familiar with this case, you looked at these pictures and you knew it was a home run. They were as clear as day. Side, front, back, you know, everything. It was something we could take and use as a tool to turn this thing around.
Focusing on Catherine Grieg was the linchpin with the case, and then led to the creation of the public service announcement, which it's my belief that that's what captured him.
This is an announcement by the FBI. Have you seen this woman? The FBI is offering $100,000 for tips leading to Catherine Grieg's whereabouts.
When the media campaign was proposed to me, I believe it was probably in the late fall of 2010, about 4 or 5 months after I'd arrived as special agent in charge, I supported it totally. And we convinced FBI to support it too. It was not an insignificant amount of money to spend to execute that campaign. Again, I believe it was about $50,000 that we paid to have that 30-second piece produced.
We asked ourselves one central question. What type of vehicle, what type of platform can we create where we can control our own content to specifically target a demographic? And the demographic was the daytime audience that would be paying attention to her, not so much him, but focus on her.
We marketed it in 16 cities in the United States where we had received previous tips indicating that Whitey and Catherine might have been there. But uniquely, it was not run in the Los Angeles market because we had not had any tips that he had been in the Los Angeles area in the past. The fact that it was picked up in the national news media by Fox News, by CNN, and others, and broadcast worldwide, that's what gave us the reach to really get the tip that brought Whitey Bulger and Catherine Grieg to justice.
The FBI is publicizing the search for Ms. Grieg in a unique way. The FBI has produced a public service announcement, a PSA, that will begin airing tomorrow on selected TV stations around the country. This 30-second PSA is specifically designed to make the public aware of Ms. Grieg's relationship with Bulger and to make the public aware of her physical characteristics.
The final reward for his capture was $2 million. That was an important asset that we had at our disposal.
We had lobbied FBI headquarters and the Department of Justice to authorize that degree of award because of the seriousness of the investigation and because of the crimes of which Mr. Bulger and Ms. Grieg had been accused, and because of the fact that he had been on the lam for 16 years. I mean, it was just, we felt $2 million was something that would be worthwhile to somebody to give us that tip, and I'm proud that that award money has been dispensed. That's a lot of money for the FBI to pay for a fugitive, but it was money extremely, extremely well spent.
I've been on America's Most Wanted. I've had cases on America's Most Wanted. Sometimes, you know, the right person is watching that, the TV program or the PSAs, and they call it right in.
We would take shifts, day shift, night shift, to intake calls and prioritize them.
During the publicity campaign, we received several hundred tips. I mean, we would receive tips that I saw him in a mall 2 years ago, you know, with no name, no license plate number. I mean, a great majority of those tips you really can't run with.
Within 48 hours of this, publicity release and the release of the public service announcement, we got information as to where Bulger and Grieg might be based on a name and recognition of photographs.
We got a tip from an individual who believed that the tipster knew Bulger and Grieg, where they lived, even gave her an exact address in Santa Monica, California.
They wanted to remain anonymous. We honor that. Anybody that calls in that does not want their identity revealed, we do not reveal their identity.
And there were a lot of details about the tip that just seemed to fit perfectly of what we knew of Bulger and Grieg. The age difference, the heights were described exactly. The fact that they stated they were from New York. We knew Bulger and Grieg would never admit they were from Boston, but they had accents, obviously, so that would be a logical place to say they were from.
Didn't know for sure it was him yet, but the analysts, people did background on the name we had for Bulger, his Gasco name, and there wasn't a whole lot of stuff showing up as far as history, and that's one of the things you look for. You get a name that maybe a fugitive's using, and you look at it and you don't see, a car registered from this time to this time, or an address from this date to this date, or there's some discrepancies there, that turns up the heat.
The tip stated that Bulger was very nasty with a lot of the neighbors and was confrontational, where the person they believe, Kathy Grieg, was very friendly and outgoing. There's also a description of their love of animals, that they had fed a stray cat in the neighborhood, and that they both loved animals. Just everything about the tip sounded exactly like all we had been told over the years. We took it seriously. We immediately sent the lead to the Los Angeles office and asked for them to investigate the tip immediately. We told them it should be a high priority, and it sounded like it could possibly be them.
This part of Santa Monica is attractive to live because we're right near the beach. We are two blocks from the 3rd Street Promenade, Montana Shopping District area is two blocks away. So there's Pacific Park is two blocks away. You can bike to Venice, you can bike to the pier, you can walk to the pier. There's just a lot of stuff to do. It's really nice, it's always sunny.
I received contact from our office back in Boston. It was actually through a intermediary person that was assigned to the Boston office who knew me from years before. I'd worked in fugitives. And he had reached out because they had received a tip the previous night regarding Catherine and Whitey. I happened to be off that week, had to get a babysitter, take care of the kids, reached out from my LAPD guys that were working that day, sent them out a text, said, let's meet in Santa Monica, we have to cover this lead. And we rallied down in Santa Monica probably early afternoon on the 22nd.
I'd taken off work early that day. I was taking a nap on my couch. I had plans to go see a concert in Hollywood. And it was really like I'd been working every day for a couple weeks because our own site manager was out of town. And I got a call from a person at the front desk that day, and she said to, the FBI's here and they need to speak to you. And so I went over there and he threw a folder down on my desk and opened it, and there was a picture of these two people and, like one of those America's Most Wanted. It was pretty obvious that Carol was Catherine Grieg. And it took a second to kind of put Charlie and Jim Bulger together, but, yeah. The first time I met Charlie, I was in my apartment playing guitar, and he knocked on my door and introduced himself, and he gave me a black Stetson cowboy hat. He would occasionally come knock on my door and, to shoot the shit or whatever. He could talk, he liked to talk, and I would see her all the time. Just very nice, always smiling. They were neighbors. They weren't my best friends. They were neighbors who were super nice to me and gave me gifts over the year, as they did many other people that they took a liking to in the building and in the neighborhood. I think anybody in this neighborhood who lived here for long enough during the time they were here and had a dog, they probably knew him and probably talked to him multiple times, because they would stop and talk to anybody who had a pet. They really liked animals. I also knew other people in the building, especially people who had kids. He would, buy presents for and stuff like that. They were kind of your typical Santa Monica, older, retired couple that moved out here to live near the beach in their last days, I guess. I mean, you could walk around this neighborhood and you would see someone right now that looked exactly like him. Like jeans, white hair, some kind of Panama jag hat, glasses, a beard, a white beard. It's eerie how many people look like him in this neighborhood. After I confirmed with the agent that the person he was looking for was my neighbor, you know, he kind of said, look, we could use your help getting this guy out of his apartment without anybody getting hurt. At that point, I knew that I was gonna be with them whether I helped them or not until they got this guy in cuffs. And, you know, I really wanted to go to this concert that night.
In the meantime, what I did was I tried as best as I could to corroborate, eliminate that the names Charles and Charlie and Carol Gasco were either real people, fictitious people, or I could possibly eliminate them through some other methods rather than having to do some surveillance.
I showed him where he could set up an agent at the hotel that had good access across the street to the apartment, to his balcony because it faced 3rd Street.
Our observation post noticed that there was a female coming out into the balcony. He was able to get a look at the female, and he thought it looked very similar to Catherine, which still, you know, everything's positive at this point. But we still had no signs of Whitey. The manager thought that Whitey had been ill, hadn't seen him in a couple of weeks.
We went over to my apartment because I told him I lived next door, and we went kind of back way through the back alley and through the back so we wouldn't walk in front of across 3rd Street where he could see us. And we got up here and I drew him a floor plan of the Gasco's apartment.
Went upstairs, tried to determine if there's any noise in there, couldn't hear any noise, couldn't see anything through the windows. I was also trying to figure out a ruse that we could use, that we could knock on a door and identify if there was a male in there.
He asked me if I'd go knock on the door a few times, which I didn't really want to do.
In my view, seeing the female was good, but it wasn't crucial. We had to see, we were looking for him. And I was a little worried that if this was him, maybe he had gotten, he tipped off, either by somebody in the building that I was talking to, or maybe when the media, that he had also seen the public service announcement that the Bureau had put out. While I was coming through the back door of the Princess Eugenia Apartments into the subterranean garage, I noticed that there were some storage bins or storage lockers above the carports, and I had asked the manager if any of those belonged to Whitey and Catherine in apartment 303. He told me which one it was, and I told him what we were gonna do was I was gonna cut the lock off his storage locker, and we're gonna make it appear as if there had been a burglary of the storage locker, and that he was going to call up to their apartment and tell them that someone had broken in and that for them to come down to the garage and to look to see if anything was taken.
You know, I stood lookout while he broke the lock open, and then we came back up to my apartment.
Decided to call up to our main office, which is a few miles away, and get some more extra support perimeter bodies, that when we were in the garage, we needed people to cover the perimeter just in case. As we were making the call, they decided to come out for a walk. They went out the back door, they went out the side door, the front door.
I gave them a call, and they didn't answer. And I had actually never called their number before, and it went to some strange, like, it didn't even go to a voicemail. It, like, went to nothing and then made some noise and then hung up. So I called the agent, and I said, they didn't answer, and he said, you sure you don't want to go up there and bring him down? And I was like, yeah, positive. You know, what if he has a gun?
Well, thinking for plan B, he calls me and said that Catherine had just called, returned his call, and that she was sending Charlie down to the garage.
I said, look, some storage units have been broken into. You know, I just want to give you guys a call. I'm either going to call the police or, you know, I can meet Charlie in the garage and look and see if anything was taken. And so she said, you know, yeah, Charlie, he'll be down in a couple minutes.
So we sat, we waited, we heard the elevator come down the chute. Sure enough, through my rearview mirror, I saw an elderly man with a white hat on, you know, crisp, clean clothes, to make a turn out of the elevator room and go towards his storage bin and turn, and he looked at the storage bin. So, and that's when we approached him and made the arrest. He did give us a couple of quick steps to his right, like he was gonna run, but we weren't too concerned about being outpaced by an 81-year-old man. initially refused to get down on his knees. Turned out he had some clean pants on, didn't want to bend down in the grease. Expletives were going back and forth, you know, more so from him. You know, kind of an old gangster type toughness. It was more of a verbal resistance than physical. Once we started talking about Catherine, I think he softened up and he wanted to make sure Catherine was in any kind of harm's way.
Scott texts me and he says, Bulger in custody, stand by for Catherine. And I couldn't believe it. I just couldn't believe it. I took my phone, I threw it across the room and kind of jumped in the air. I couldn't believe that it was so quick.
Bulger in custody. And you're just, okay, Bulger in custody. Going on to the next one, go to get her, you know, and then the next page, you know, whatever time it was later, both in custody. It's done.
I brought them both together, and I asked them both if it was okay if we got consent to search the apartment. He looked at her, he told her we were gonna get the search warrant anyway, might as well give the consent, let's get this over with. And when we removed the handcuff from Whitey and he signed his name, he mentioned that that was the first time he'd signed that name in a long time. He made it clear at that point that he was cooperating for consideration for Catherine. I'm assuming that he knew that he was done and that he wanted any kind of cooperation that he was doing as far as the consent and the search, that it would go to Catherine's benefit.
He's kind of surrounded by agents. You know, he's in cuffs. He's like talking to him, laughing. She was kind of standing there in cuffs and she was like, there was like, well, maybe one agent with her. You know, she was like, hi, Josh. And I was like.
We're always taught to don't take any situation for granted. Don't take it lightly. In hindsight, having seen his apartment and seeing the amount of loaded weapons that were easily accessible to him, it kind of bears that out, and it kind of reinforces, you know, what you've always been taught. It was quite a find. A lot of cash, lots of weapons, some loaded, some unloaded, lots of fake IDs.
The agents asked me to walk through with them to look at the walls to see if any of the work was done by our maintenance guy. And I could, you know, there were just people everywhere. There were guns all over the floor. There was money and stuff. It was insane. They were just like tagging and boxing guns and stuff.
There was a secret stash behind the bar area that adjoined the living room and the kitchen. He had carved out the drywall between the studs, and he had stashed most of the money, which turned out to be approximately $823,000, I believe.
And they had taken down all these pictures, and behind the pictures there were like very cleanly cut holes in the wall with like blue tape and stuff, so he wouldn't cut his arm. He was going for more cash.
There's also a weapon stash in there. He had told us there was a grenade, but not to be worried that it was inert. And he showed us he had a hollowed out book with a compartment in it. They stashed a loaded Derringer. There were revolvers behind other books on the bookshelf. Interesting bunch of evidence they found.
Woke up to the news, and it was just, you know, it was a little groggy. It was like 6:30 in the morning. Said that Whitey Bulger has been captured.
And breaking news, a crime boss from the FBI's 10 most wanted list finally captured tonight here in Southern California.
Glenn, what a night this is. The so-called globe-trotting godfather of South Boston arrested tonight on the streets of Santa Monica. He and his girlfriend arrested here. Whitey is in custody.
It really was like a small bomb went off. You could tell it was going to be a meteor firestorm.
Today marks the moment of when James Whitey Bulger will finally face justice for a number of his crimes, including extortion, money laundering, RICO conspiracy, and RICO murders related to 19 individuals that he is allegedly to have committed.
I didn't think the story was going to have a happy ending. I thought he was going to get away with it. I thought he was going to die a free man. The reason this woman knew Whitey and Catherine Gregg is because they were taking care of a stray cat. And the cat brings them down.
And it was just like a relief. I mean, such a relief. It was like, since 1980, we've been trying to make this happen. And it's finally over. But always to the trial.
And this is a great day for Boston's law enforcement community. However, I do want to take a moment to remember the families of the victims named in the federal indictment who have waited years for justice.
What's fascinating to me and what surprised me was just to discover an old man sitting in an apartment covered with black plastic, watching television, clipping Maalox coupons, and complaining about black people. That was his freedom. His fugitive years were largely spent as a grumpy old man.
If I would have known that he was Whitey Bulger, or thought he was Whitey Bulger, I would have probably tried to get my hands on that $2 million. I mean, and I wouldn't have really... I probably wouldn't have thought much about that, you know?
I believe Osama bin Laden was captured and terminated, shall we say, about a month and a half before we arrested Whitey Bulger. So it was a great six-week period for the FBI to have two of our top 10 fugitives, how shall we say, taken off the list in various ways.
It's really important that Whitey Bulger, no matter how old he is, be brought to justice, and he was, all right? And in the course of that process of being brought back and then put on trial, in no uncertain terms, for those who didn't already know from the volumes of journalistic accounts and books that have been written and all the civil lawsuits that the victims' families have brought against the government and trying to hold the government accountable for the murders of their family members, that this guy's an animal and a beast and a monster. And the unholy alliance with the FBI is the scandal of all scandals when it comes to the FBI. There it is, on center stage again. That's really important for everyone to see that.
What I particularly resented was any insinuation that the FBI was never serious about capturing Whitey Bulger, because an agent in the past had been convicted of assisting him. That was one agent. There were hundreds and hundreds of other agents from that time onward that devoted their careers, or parts of their career, shall we say, to finding Whitey Bulger. And I was particularly incensed and resentful of anybody who accused the FBI of never taking the hunt for Whitey Bulger seriously. We did. When I got to Boston in July of 2010, I told the Boston media it was one of my highest priorities. We're gonna focus like a laser beam on capturing him, and we did.
I was lucky in a sense. I only spent 9 months working this case, but it was all-consuming, and there were agents, there were analysts that had spent years and years and years of their life trying to locate Whitey Bulger.
You know, it really doesn't matter at the end of the day who gets the credit. It's, I think at the end of the day, the streets are safer and everybody's doing their job, and you move on to the next one.
And from the videos that we had and photographs we had from the 1980s, that became important in 2013. Is that something else? So everybody that worked that case along with me finally had some vindication of our effort was not in vain.
I feel good for the victims and their families. That's what it's about, getting justice for the victims and the families. They're still grieving, but at least they know James Whitey Bulger has been taken in custody, he's been found guilty, and he will sit in jail till his last days on Earth.
When crimes like that are committed, the FBI doesn't forgive and it doesn't forget. And we never forgave Whitey Bulger. We never forgot Whitey Bulger. I'm satisfied that we fulfilled that commitment to the American public and to the victims of his crimes. I'm very happy and satisfied that justice has been served. And Mr. Bulger is now in federal penitentiary. Ms. Grieg is now in federal penitentiary. And that's exactly where they should be.
It's hard to add up the damage that was done, except that it's enormous and bleeds in every direction. Law enforcement at every level, local, state, and federal, was at odds for so long, so that it's so deeply embedded and it's part of the dynamic here. That's not good for public safety and for justice. There are a number of murders that happened on FBI time, and the FBI has blood on its hands. I think a bunch of people got away with crimes that they'll never be convicted of.